Hello, and welcome to UEA TV's news show for everything UEA, Viewpoint. Coming up on this edition, we will be looking at the latest news on campus and in Norwich from the last week. Over the past 2 weeks, several important events have been hosted at UEA, including one of the most eagerly anticipated events of the UEA sporting calendar, Derby Day. This year, UEA were victorious, beating Essex 36-9, and UEA TV and Concrete were all over campus, bringing in the latest updates throughout the day. Take a look at some of the highlights.
I've paid my dues.
Hi, my name's Annabelle Blake and I'm from UEA TV.
I'm Miss Jackson reporting for UEA TV for Derby Day.
I'm here with Chris and Reese from the cricket team.
I'm here with Will, who's in defence for the Mensa Cross team.
I'm here with two members of UEA Women's football team.
I'm here with Harry Mack at the pole dancing.
Currently having intense chats behind me.
Congratulations on your win, boys.
Met up with Louise Chadwick, president of the women's football, to discuss their victory over Essex on Derby Day by 2-1. Take a look.
It's always great to win on Derby Day, and as there were so many cancellations and rearrangements of other teams, it was really good that we managed to play, even though we were playing on AstroTurf, which isn't our normal surface. We're usually on the grass colony, and it was really good to play, like, at all. It was a bit stressful for me, anyway, as I was getting phone calls from the union saying, oh, we don't know if we're going to be able to play or not. But I managed to ring a few of the girls in our team, and we set about 7 or 8 freshers down, freshers and like older people as well. They all went down and helped out with clearing the pitches, which was really, really good. And also they went and helped hockey out with clearing up the pitches. And Essex also came down and did exactly the same, which was really kind of community spirited of them, which was nice. And I think, you know, if you've travelled an hour and a half to get up here, I think you'd probably want to play as well. The game itself was really tough. We had all seasons of weather in like a space of an hour and a half. So it started off and it was sunny, and then the clouds came over and it started to like snow, and then we had hail. And then it was sunny again, and then it rained again. But in the actual game playing way. It could have been better, but it was good. I think the fact that it was a really hard fought sort of battle between us and Essex was kind of summarised like the year that we've had. It's been a pretty tough year for us, but it was really good to get the win out of it at the end, because obviously everyone, you play Derby Day to win, so it was really good. Home advantage is always the best, because I've played home and away, so home advantage is just amazing, because you feel like you've got there's an extra person on your team. There's like, you have all your friends and everyone that's supported you over the last sort of 7 or 8 months, Bucks and stuff. Everyone's there, everyone's cheering for you, and it's really nice to just get everyone. It's like a day where the whole university kind of like unites, and it's really good that, that we have that kind of community spirit. When you play away, it's weird because everyone is against you. You always feel there's like an air of hostility around you, but then you use that as like another source of like motivation and kind of, you can think, oh, I've got to win because, these people are all cheering for somebody else, so, it's like most of it. But yeah, being at home is obviously better. This is my last year, so being at home for my last one was pretty good, because then, I had people come and watch me, like my friends came to watch me, we don't get audiences very often, and it was just really nice to have everyone there at the same time. And I mean, the fact that it was all taking place in the sports park is that you could go and see everything if you really wanted to. It was just a bit of a shame that some things did get cancelled because of the weather.
In other news, Livewire's Jailbreak weekend was a huge success. With the help of strangers, train conductors and airport staff, over 20 teams managed to make it to Madrid, Rome, Krakow and Bratislava, with the winning team making it 1,963 miles away to Cyprus. Sophie recently met up with Alex Valentine and Kate Marks, the organisers of the weekend.
Okay, so tell us more about how the Jailbreak weekend went.
Well, it was very good. It was very, very good. It was like a long kind of weekend, because we were up pretty much like the whole time, like in and out of the library, because we had our base camp in the library.
Yeah, how many teams were there?
Oh, 25, wasn't it?
Yeah,
that made out. We had a few more that started, but a few kind of dropped out near the end, so we had 25 like good ones that went forward.
And how was your role located in the Jailbreak base camp?
It was good. We were taking like updates from like all the teams. We had like a massive spreadsheet that we made, and then just whenever they texted in, we'd log details and put the map, move little dots around on the map.
Was it 24 hours that you were in the library, or did you have shifts? And
yeah, we did like a couple of shifts, but there was always someone there like the whole 14 hours, like actually on that base camp.
And how did you connect with the teams then from the library? Was it like text, or did you use the internet?
Kind of a mixture of both, yeah. Really. We had three Jailbreak phones, which was pretty exciting, because it felt a bit like James Bond.
It was like spies, we had our little gadgets.
Yeah, so we had our gadgets, we had Twitter feed, so you could hashtag Jailbreak UEA, or what else?
We had like our mobile numbers as well, didn't we? So we would have there were like loads of different things they could contact us with, so they were like pretty safe.
And how much money did you raise for the charity Cancer Research?
Oh, it was good.
Should we say it at the same time?
Ready?
Well, I was just going to say, let's say the number. Yeah, okay.
Over £14,000.
Wow. That's a lot. How much were you, did you have like a ballpoint figure you were expecting to reach?
Well, we put like a target, but it was one of those targets you never expect to actually get to.
Yeah.
So at the beginning of the process, we said that we were going to do like £10,000, and
that was quite steep, wasn't it?
Before we left, it was £10,000, wasn't it?
Yeah. Before they'd even like actually started £10,000,
wow.
Then like as their stories kept coming in, like the families were like checking what they were doing, and donated like all the money. So.
And how did that compare to the amount of money raised last year for Jailbreak?
Last year was a groundbreaking year again, but it was 7,400 that was raised last year for the same charity, so we've pretty much done
pretty
it.
Much.
That's really good.
It's been good, yeah.
Reports came in from Twitter about Dovergate. Can you explain what happened?
Dovergate. It was basically like, they all kind of went to Dover, because that was like the, how you get into like Europe and stuff like that, and we just got completely, they got completely stuck. They couldn't get across, they were struggling to do that.
Because there's like a technique of like where to stand in Dover, like there's different points where like you're allowed to and not allowed to. And so there were some people who had done Jailbreak before, so they knew where to.
Do you think this year's use of interaction with the moving map and the Twitter updates and a live timeline made it possible for everyone to get involved and enjoy the Jailbreak weekend and probably gave it more publicity than perhaps last year?
Yeah. I reckon so, yeah, because we did, like, last year they had the map and stuff like that, and I think they had Twitter still, didn't they?
They had Twitter and a blog, yeah.
Yeah, so it was, I think, like this year, because we had the tablets working with us as well, and, like, were you able to see it? Like their website at all.
Yeah,
like,
did. I actually got retweeted, actually.
Yes.
I'm very proud. Thought I'd like participate a little bit.
Yeah,
it was
it,
so
yeah.
easy to keep up with what everyone was doing.
That's what it's about. They made it really good to like keep track of it. So we had all the stuff that we did last year, but it was just that it was available like a lot better, I think. And like with the tab, they just helped us out quite a lot.
Yeah, absolutely. And it just generated this really lovely feeling of community that even if you weren't doing the Jailbreak,
yeah.
you were
That's
supporting
it.
Them or being helping out base camp, and that's what it was about,
yeah.
really.
It was good fun.
And so tell us more about Livewire's plans for the future. What's your next event hearing aid about?
Oh, well,
Buddy, you should mention that. Ta-da!
We have a brand new event coming up.
It's not brand new.
It's not brand new. It's old as time.
Hearing aid was what Jailbreak is part of.
Right.
So it's kind of like the umbrella fundraising event. It's going to be really exciting. It's going to be so good.
Because they used to do it like last year. Did you go to like St. Paddy's? Like, oh no, because you're a fresh runner.
Yeah. I went to St. Paddy's this year though.
It was so good. But they used to do it like every year. They'd have it during the day, St. Paddy's. Then people go to the LCR stuff like that. But because we couldn't have it this year, because like all the rugby. So we've gone for the Returners LCR, which is like the next kind of big one coming up.
Okay, this Saturday.
Oh, and it's...
It's the 13th of April.
Yes,
yeah,
so it's that
Saturday.
Oh,
the Returners
Saturday,
sorry, yeah.
Because we've got... Yes, yeah, the last chance one, isn't it? This
yeah,
one,
this
is
the last chance.
Yeah, so yeah, so next one after that. But it's before that, we're going to have the Blue Bar. And
we've got some really exciting acts lined up. So we've got the winner and runner-up of Unsigned, which was our Battle of the Bands last semester. So we've got Cielo, Koi Poraga. We've got some open mic night. With a variety of really exciting acts. We've got a magician,
yeah.
We've got Take Me Out.
Okay.
So another round of those, and it's going to be a really good...
And that's with the Blue
so
Bar.
Good.
Yeah,
the Blue Bar.
And then we like buckets with like for cancer research, so we're just going to get as much money just kind of for that as well as we can. It's like another big fundraiser, but it's not like... You aren't going to get probably as much as Jailbreak or anything from this. It's just a few buckets, and like if you want to donate then do that. And we might... We're doing a raffle as well, aren't we?
Yeah.
If you want a raffle table with some very good prizes on.
Very
so you definitely
prizes.
Get a ticket for that if you attend. And hope you win the prize.
Thank you for talking to us at UEA TV. And good luck with your future events.
Thank you for having us.
Another event that's taken part on campus in the past fortnight is Strictly UEA. Run by a collaboration of UEA dance societies, Strictly UEA partnered 14 members of union clubs and societies with experienced dancers, having 3 months to assign and teach them a new dance. To find out more about how the event went, take a look.
Hi, I'm Dean from UEA TV. Nice to see you, nice. We here at UEA TV cover several big events, but tonight we're at one of the biggest student-run events of the year, Strictly UEA. Basically, UEA's answer to Strictly Come Dancing. We hope you enjoy.
Hi, I'm Chris from Concrete, and tonight we're live blogging Strictly UEA.
I am Rob, and this is Emma. We're at the LCR Strictly Come Dancing.
Hi, I'm Gerd Aswali. I'm the president of UEA Dance Sport and one of the principal organisers, along with Chloe Rochester, of Strictly UEA. We came up with the idea of Strictly UEA last year and have developed it to make it bigger and better this year. This year we have 14 clubs from various sports competing. We've paired them up with our professional dancers, and over the last 10 weeks they have been taught a dance. Tonight they're going to perform that dance and interject. There'll be showpieces. The reason we ran the event was to build relationships between the clubs, get to know each other, which this year has definitely done, but it's also been a fundraising activity. So we've raised money not only for ourselves, but for the sports competitors. They've sold tickets, and through their ticket sales, the money, part of the money from their ticket sales goes back towards the club. So every club competing gets to make some money. Oh!
looked great. And recently, Sophie met up with the event organisers, Gerdes and Chloe. Take a look at their interview.
I'm here with Gerdes and Chloe from UEA Dance Sport. Congratulations on the success of Strictly UEA this year. How do you feel the show went?
Thank you. We thought the show went fantastically well. Everyone seemed to really enjoy themselves. We managed to pack out the LCR with even more people this year than we did last. So, no, we were really happy. The standard of competition was a lot, lot higher this year as well. So, no, we were very happy with it overall.
As the president of Dance Sport, as well as being one of the organisers and performers, did your interest in dance start before UEA, or did it begin once you got here?
Mine personally started when I came to UEA. My partner's one of my best friends. We've known each other for quite a while, and we took up ballroom dancing literally on a whim. It was something we saw advertised and thought, oh, we'll pop along to that, and sort of 3.5 years later, we're still here.
I'm sure you had to remain impartial, but were there any performances on the night that were your favourite?
I think the right people were in the top three. It was a very close top field in terms of competition, but I think the top three held their nerve really well, and they performed to the best of their ability. And I think it was so close on the night between the three of them that I wouldn't have liked to be the one to call a winner that night.
Not only did you dance in the opening number, but you also presented the show. Did you get any performance day nerves?
Fearless doesn't get it often. He doesn't get nerves at all.
You don't get nerves at all?
No, you stick me on a stage in front of a bunch of people with a microphone and I'm the happiest guy alive. I love doing that. So no, I've enjoyed presenting it both years.
So some of the professional members at this year's Strictly UEA were actually beginners at last year's Strictly UEA. Do you feel there's been an increase in the interest of UEA Dancing Society since the event?
Definitely. We've had a number of the competitors last year that have actually joined our society this academic year, and they've competed with us on our circuit, on our open circuit, and around the country at the competitions that we go to. And again, after this Strictly, we've had almost half the competitors join our dance club as well. So it's a great way of not only increasing numbers, but just increasing like connections with other sports at UEA. So
you don't have to be part of a dance society already here to join the Strictly UEA event?
No, one of the stipulations that we have is that you're not one of our members if you're going to compete, because what we like is that you're coming to it without any ballroom or dancing sort of experience.
Okay.
So we actually say that you can't be a member of our club if you're a competitor. But a lot of the competitors have joined afterwards. Yeah.
We have a competition coming up in May, and I think 4 or 5 of them have already signed up to go to it. And
wow.
Apart from the dance that they did on the night, they've never actually danced before, so they're all really keen.
Yeah, so have you got any other events that are coming up that you can come and watch or get involved in?
Well, we've got a competition that we're going away for in May in Manchester, but we've got a fundraiser that we're going to be doing at some time in May. The date's not quite confirmed yet, but we're going to be dancing to a 30-piece brass band outside the Forum in Centre.
Oh, okay, yeah.
So we'll be putting on demonstrations and show dances to them.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you very much for coming to talk to UEA TV, and good luck with the future competitions.
Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Gerdes, and congratulations on the success of Strictly UEA and for raising so much money for union sports clubs and societies. In other news, UEA Macmillan Society recently hosted an event to celebrate Macmillan's charity work in Norwich. At the event, the charity's Norwich representatives, including UEA Society President Tim Walker, gave speeches followed by a chance for guests to discuss opportunities to fundraise. UEA TV were there to film the day. Take a look.
So we've had your test results back from the lab, and we've sat down, my team and I, and reviewed them, and I'm sorry to have to tell you that it's not good news. It is cancer. What we're going to do next...
This is the new Macmillan Cancer Awareness advertising campaign, released just a few weeks ago, with the tagline, "No one should face cancer alone."
Do you have any questions?
I don't think so.
No one should face cancer alone.
With your support, no one will.
With the new campaign taking the UK by storm, hundreds of regional events occurred across the country on 16th of March to create awareness of the charity and its new plans.
Thank you very much for coming today. It's wonderful to see so many of you here in your own free time. So today I just want to tell you a little bit about what Macmillan do. It sounds like a scary percentage, but 42% of us at some point will be diagnosed with cancer. It used to be thrown around that it was 1 in 3, but it's actually 42%. And the reason being is that we live longer. So there's nothing scary happening, it's just the fact that we live longer. And there's so many cures for other things that at some point 42% of us will be affected. When I spoke to somebody recently, they said, they're the nurses that deal with you when you're about to die. It's end of life. Well, no, Macmillan aren't that. We, hopefully what we do is we support you throughout the journey. So from initial diagnosis, all the way through to hopefully living through and beyond cancer and life after that. So our nurses will include people like clinical specialists, who'll talk to you in the hospital, put you in touch with support groups. There'll be medical specialists, oncologists, radiologists. And then hopefully, we've now launched the survivorship programme in Norfolk, where we've got the community nurses. You'll be given almost like a pack to take with you when you go out of hospital, and that will have all the support networks that you need, exercise plans, and access to the TC3 programme.
First of all, thank you for everyone coming today. I very much appreciate your time. I've actually written something, because it's the first time I've ever done this before. So bear with me if I actually end up reading off. I'm also the president and creator of UEA's first Macmillan Society, better known as UEA Macmillan. Combined with previous volunteer work back home in Kent and planning various student events back there as well, I got discovered by the Norfolk region of the charity and was appointed as student ambassador for this region, and I'm here to tell you what I basically do. As a student representative for UEA, it's my job to get students more involved in the course. Before the new advertising campaign, which we will put on later on, Luke, and before Natalie came along as well, Norfolk's Macmillan campaign was aimed at an older generation. For example, Coffee Morning has always been ideologically represented as an older event. The previous advertising campaign reinforced the idea of sitting around drinking hot drinks and eating cake. Again, it's not a bad thing, but there are a lot of other ways that we can raise money with younger people as well. For example, Norwich's music, arts and club scene is one of the biggest and well-known in the UK. Hence, it was actually one of the reasons why I came to UEA, because the music scene is that great. And now, let's not be blunt, students do like to go out, and not necessarily in a bad way or anything like that, but people like to go out and have a good time, especially around Norwich, because there are so many opportunities in terms of different styles of music. There are so many different club nights around here. And it doesn't even have to be with pubs and clubs. A lot of people go to the Arts Centre or, I'm trying to think where else, Sainsbury's Arts Centre as well. With spectacular venues, which I know we should have things penciled in, I think, according to Natalie, with Bam Bam just down there, Karma Cafe, which I've done stuff before, Hideout, which again is just up there, Tau as well, and where else, Beluga of course, and the Norwich Arts Centre. There are so many other ways we can interact with students. Having held the Macmillan Crawl last February, basically I just decided, you know what, well, we need to raise some money for Macmillan because there isn't a society around. We'll launch a big crawl where students walk around to each venue, buy a drink, donate some money to charity in any way they can, and carry on. And throughout the way, we got buckets shaken all over the venues, and we raised about £800 just for one night. And it does prove the fact that we can, just how easy it is just to raise money. And no venue has ever said to me, no, we don't want to hold it, because it shows a positive image for them. So it again is another idea, another way that we can grasp such opportunities. And I'm privileged to be a part of the change to get this wonderful organisation existent around younger audiences. So thank you. Sorry, I wrote a bit off paper. But if you guys want to chat to me afterwards, then I'm around. Awesome.
Such a great week for events at UEA, and all that's left for us to say now is thank you to our guests for joining us, and thank you for watching Viewpoint. Don't forget to find us on YouTube and discover our Derby Day playlist or pick up a copy of Concrete for the latest news on campus. We'll be back in a couple of weeks for your fix of news and features. Thanks for watching.